Last video, we saw that if a set is linearly independent, then any subset is also linearly independent. Therefore, the larger the set, the more interesting the set would be. Thus, we talked about maximally linearly independent sets. And we also saw many properties of maximally linearly independent sets. Now, we will see that if a set of vectors span a vector space, then any superset would also span the vector space. This means that the smallest set of vectors that span the vector space would be most interesting. More precisely, let V be a vector space. Then, span of V1 to Vn is equal to the vector space V implies that span of a set S is equal to V whenever the set V1 to Vn is contained inside the set S. That is, whenever a set of vectors spans a vector space, any superset also spans the vector space. Now notice that this statement is kind of obvious. As the set V1, V2, etc. up to Vn is a subset of the set S, it is obvious that the smallest subspace that contains the vectors V1 to Vn is contained inside the smallest subspace that contains the set S. However, the smallest subspace that contains V1 to Vn is equal to the span of the vectors V1 to Vn. That is how we define the span of V1 to Vn. Thus, the span of V1 to Vn is contained inside the smallest subspace that contains S. But we have assumed that V1 to Vn span the vector space V. In other words, span of V1 to Vn is the vector space V itself. So together, we have that the vector space V is a subset of the smallest subspace that contains S. But obviously, the smallest subspace that contains S is a subspace of the vector space V. So together, we have that V is equal to the smallest subspace that contains S. And that proves the claim. Now, even though the statement was kind of obvious, it helps to recognize this fact because this will guide a lot of further study. Thus, smaller a spanning set, the more interesting it would be. Therefore, we will be most interested in a minimal spanning set. A minimal spanning set is rigorously defined as follows. Let V be a vector space. A set S is called a minimal spanning set if S spans the vector space V, or in other words, the smallest subspace that contains S is equal to V. And moreover, if you take any set that is smaller than S, that means any set that is strictly contained in S, then the span of T is also a strict subspace of V. Let us now look at some examples of minimal spanning sets. First, we will look at the vector space R2 and look at some examples of minimal spanning sets in R2. The first example among these would be the set that contains the element 1,0 and 0,1. Notice that this set spans the vector space R2. However, if we take any smaller subset, that means we take the single element 1,0 or 0,1, then that would not span R2. Therefore, this set is minimal. Similarly, another example of a minimal spanning set in R2 would be the set that contains the two elements 1,1 and 1,-1. Once again, it is not very difficult to show that this set spans. If it's unclear to you, I leave it as an exercise. However, if we take a proper subset, that means if we take only one of the vectors, say 1, 1 or 1, comma minus 1, then that vector cannot span R2. Thus, once again, this set is a minimal spanning set. Both these sets span R2. No subset of these sets will span R2. Thus, they are minimal spanning sets. Now, let us look at examples in the vector space R3. Once again, analogous to the example A when V was equal to R2, the vectors 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1 spans the vector space R3. Moreover, if you take any subset of this set, then that would not span. If you take any single vector, clearly they do not span. If you take two vectors, these two vectors for instance, then you would not get any element where the third entry is non-zero. If you take these two vectors, then in their span, you will not get any vectors such that the first entry is not zero. If you take these two vectors, the first and the third, then you would not get any vectors that has the second entry non-zero. Therefore, no subset of this set would span full of R3. That is, this set is a minimal spanning set. Similarly, it can be shown that the set 1, 1, 0, 1, minus 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1 is also a minimal spanning set. That is, the set containing these three elements spans R3. However, no subset would span R3. These are all examples of some minimal spanning sets. Now, notice something interesting. The two examples of minimal spanning sets that we saw in R2 are both examples of vectors that are linearly independent. Moreover, the minimal spanning set contained two elements. This was the same number that was present in a maximally linearly independent set. And this is no coincidence. As you can once again see that the same is true in R3. The minimal spanning set has three elements. And this was once again the same number as what was contained in a maximally linearly independent set. Moreover, you can also see that these three vectors are linearly independent. Similarly, these three vectors are also linearly independent. And this is a general phenomenon. If n vectors form a minimal spanning set, then they have to be linearly independent. More precisely, if the set containing vectors v1 to vn is a minimal spanning set, then the vectors v1 to vn are linearly independent. Let us look at a proof of this. Once again, we will prove this using a proof by contradiction. In other words, we have to start by assuming the contrary. What is the contrary in this case? The contrary would be the set v1 to vn is a minimal spanning set. But the vectors v1 to vn are not linearly independent. If v1 to vn are not linearly independent, then this would imply that there exists constants a1 to an such that all ai's are not equal to 0. In other words, the tuple a1 to an is not equal to the tuple that contains only zeros as its entries. And a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus etc up to an vn is equal to 0. Now notice that at least one of the ai's have to be non-zero. Let us assume without loss of generality that a1 is not equal to 0. If a1 is not equal to 0, then we can rearrange the earlier equation as v1 is equal to minus of a2 by a1 times v2 plus minus of a3 by a1 times v3 plus etc. up to minus of an by a1 times vn. Thus, we can see that v1 is a linear combination of the vectors v2 to vn. This implies that the set containing v2 to vn spans the vector space V. But this contradicts the fact that v1 to vn was a minimal spanning set. That is, no proper subset of the set v1 to vn spans the vector space V. Therefore, our assumption that the vectors v1 to vn are not linearly independent has to be wrong. And thus we have proved that if v1 to vn is a minimal spanning set, then the vectors v1 to vn are linearly independent. Now we can better understand why all the examples of a minimal spanning set in R2 and R3 were also maximally linearly independent. This is a result of a more general phenomenon that a set v1 to vn is minimal spanning set if and only if it is a maximally linearly independent set. Let us go through a proof of this fact. We will first prove that if the set is a minimal spanning set, then the set is maximally linearly independent. The previous theorem told us that if the vectors v1 to vn is a minimal spanning set, then the vectors v1 to vn are linearly independent. So all that we have to show is that it is maximally linearly independent. In other words, if V is any vector in the vector space V, then the vectors v1 to vn and V are not linearly independent. This is obvious because the vectors v1 to vn span the vector space V. Therefore, the vector V can be written as a linear combination a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus etc. up to an vn, which implies that we can write a1 v1 plus a2 v2 plus etc. up to an vn minus v is equal to 0. Now notice that not all constants are equal to 0. It would be clearer if we write minus v as plus of minus 1 into v. Now minus 1 is not equal to 0, thus all constants are not 0. Thus, we can show that the vectors v1 to vn and v is not linearly independent. Therefore, the set is a maximally linearly independent set. Now, we will show the other way implication. We will assume that the vectors v1 to vn is a maximally linearly independent set, and we will show that it's a minimal spanning set. In the previous video, we saw that a maximally linearly independent set spans. Therefore, all we have to show is that it is a minimal spanning set. We already know that it spans, so all we have to show is that any smaller set cannot span. Now, this is kind of obvious. If S is a strict subset of the set V1 to Vn, then there exists at least one element from V1 to Vn that is not there in S. Therefore, we can assume without loss of generality that V1 does not belong to the set S. At least one of the vectors is not contained in S. We are assuming that that vector is equal to V1. Otherwise, we can just renumber it. That's all. Right? So, let's assume that V1 does not belong to the set S. Then, can the span of S be equal to V? In other words, does V1 belong to the span of the vectors S? Suppose it belongs. Suppose V1 belongs to the span of the vectors in S, then that means V1 is a linear combination of the vectors that are in S. But S contains only vectors from V2 to Vn. Of course, it need not contain all the vectors, but it can at max contain vectors V2 to Vn. So this implies that I can write V1 as A2 V2 plus A3 V3 plus etc. up to An Vn. Notice that here some of the AIs can be zero. And whenever a particular VI does not belong to S, we will make that AI equal to zero. So if suppose V1 belongs to the span of S, then we can always write it in this fashion. That's the idea. But as soon as we can write it in this fashion, this implies that the vectors V1 to Vn are not linearly independent. But that is a contradiction. Therefore, we have answered to this question, namely, Vi does not belong to the span S. Thus, we observed that if S is a proper subset of V1 to Vn, then that cannot span the vector space V. In other words, the set V1 to Vn is a minimal spanning set. The previous theorem says that if vectors V1 to Vn form a minimal spanning set, then they are maximally linearly independent. But we saw that if V1 to Vn form a maximally linearly independent set in R2, then n has to be equal to 2. And V1 and V2 should be linearly independent. Thus, it is easy to prove that if V1 to Vn is a minimal spanning set in R2, then n is equal to 2 and vectors V1 and V2 are linearly independent. This is already very clear, and maybe it doesn't make sense to call it a homework, but I'm calling it a homework so that you write it and make sure that you have understood this. We will end this video with one more result. Let V be a vector space, as always, and let V1 to Vn be linearly independent, and let the span of these vectors be equal to the vector space V. Then, the set V1 to Vn is maximally linearly independent, and it is also a minimal spanning set. Now, the proof of this result is very similar in idea to the proofs that we have seen so far in this video. Therefore, if you have understood all the previous proofs, you should be able to prove this theorem on your own. To verify whether you have understood the proofs so far, I will leave the proof of this theorem as a homework. I hope you will all be able to prove this result.